Matthew chapter 21. Remember last week we said that Jesus has entered Jerusalem. It's the last week of his life. And we could say, as we see his ministry at the temple, that he has come home. It is his temple. And thinking back to when he was a youth, that he must be about his Father's business. That's exactly what he's about. We know, because we know the rest of the story, where this is heading. These events are moving quickly to reach that end at Calvary. We stop because we only have a limited amount of time, but the narrative didn't stop. So it's almost like we just flip the on switch and we pick back up in Matthew's narrative. So this morning we're picking up at verse 18. The story continues. Matthew chapter 21, verse 18. This is the word of God. Early in the morning, as Jesus was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went up to it, but found nothing on it except leaves. Then he said to it, "May you never bear fruit again." Immediately the tree withered. When the disciples saw this, they were amazed. "How did the fig tree wither so quickly?" they asked. Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, if you have faith and do not doubt, not only can you do what was done to the fig tree, but also you can say to this mountain, 'Go throw yourself into the sea,' and it will be done. If you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer." Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or of human origin?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, 'Then why didn't you believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we're afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I'm doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir,' but he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. And Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The story is told of a woman who had acquired great wealth, and with that wealth had gained great social prominence. So she decided that she wanted to leave a record of her genealogy and her story. So she hired one of the greatest authors of the time to tell her story. In doing his research, he discovered that one of her grandfathers had been electrocuted in the infamous New York prison of Sing Sing. He reported to her what he had discovered. And she says, "Oh my, we can't put that in there." He says, "Ma'am, we have to. We've got to tell the story." She says, "Well, can you word it in such a way so it's not quite so demeaning?" When the book was published, here's what we read. "One of her grandfathers occupied the chair of applied electricity. in one of America's best-known institutions. He was very much attached to his position and literally died in the harness. You can't always judge a book by its cover, but you see how obsessed people can be with appearance. It's always the buzz. What does it look like? From everything to personal fashion to every new product that's put on the market to even how we look when we go out the door. We are consumed with appearance. When we return to Matthew's narrative, we see that Jesus too was concerned with appearance. And what we learn is that appearances can be quite deceiving. I remember as a little boy, my daddy told me after an encounter with an old fella in town who I learned later was quite a storyteller, quite a fabricator of truth, quite a liar. And we'd met him on the street one day downtown, and he'd told some big tale. And of course, little boy, my eyes were just big. And when we left, I said, "Wow, Dad, that was." He says, "Son, don't believe everything you hear." One of those early lessons that serves you well. Don't fall for everything, even though it appears to be real. Be careful of appearances. Jesus was very much concerned about appearances, for they can be very deceiving. Jesus hated the false religion that masqueraded as the truth of God's people. He hated that fraud that was perpetrated by the religious leaders upon God's covenant people, how they had led them astray. They had all the trappings of religion, and the people went through the motions, but their hearts were far from God. And what we learn is that trust and obedience marks the true follower of Jesus Christ. Trust and obedience marks the true follower of Jesus Christ, not the mere outward appearance. And so in this section, we see Jesus exposing the truth, the hypocrisy of the religious establishment. We begin with the fig tree incident in verses 18 through 22, and we're not going to delve into all the things that are going on here. We want to follow the line of thought that Matthew presents in his narrative. Jesus approached this fig tree expecting to find fruit because the fig tree, that particular fig tree, when it had leaves, it also had fruit. So Jesus had every reason to expect that when he went to that fig tree, there would be fruit. But when he went there, he found none. Just the appearance. You ever done that? You ever gone to a tree or a bush knowing it was time for there to be fruit, knowing that everything had bloomed, knowing that everything looked good, and you walk down there and there's nothing? Or if you ever seen a bright, shiny piece of fruit and bit into it and wanted to throw up your socks? Oh, it looked good, but it tasted awful. Won't tell you about the time I bit into one and found half a worm. That's for another sermon. But protein supplement, a friend of mine said. Somehow it didn't feel too supplemental. Jesus cursed this tree. The disciples are fascinated, and I don't know why. They've seen his power demonstrated before. But what we see is that if we remember back to the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus had said, "Every tree that does not bear fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire," Matthew 7:19. He's teaching them this principle that in the kingdom of God, we're to be fruitful. We're to grow in our faith. We're to walk with Christ, and we'll see the fruit of the Spirit within us. Very powerful illustration that begins this part of the narrative. You see, there was plenty of appearance of religious orthodoxy at the temple. Fresh in their minds was Jesus' cleansing of the temple, remember, when he drove out the money changers? There was the promise of spiritual reality, just like when you bite into that piece of fruit that looks so good. But what was found inside was a spiritual barrenness. The house of prayer had become a den of thieves. Jesus attacks the hypocrisy of those whose devotion to God was merely an outward appearance. And he's teaching them that those who do not bear fruit will be cut off like this fig tree. What is in one's heart is what's seen in their fruit, not in their leaves. It's seen in the fruit of their lives, not in the appearance. Stories told that when Howard Carter and his archaeological team began to open the sarcophagus of King Tut, that they opened that outer sarcophagus and only found inside another one. They opened it and found another one. And finally, they found one that was solid gold. And when they opened that solid gold sarcophagus, you know what they found? A shriveled up, mummified remain. Because no matter how grand and glorious the outside, inside was just a dead man. No matter how you dressed it up on the outside, inside it was still dead. Now, what about us? Do we give the appearance of being spiritually alive, and do we talk the talk when we need to? We know the right lingo and the right words, but there's no fruit. See, no matter how good you look, like the fig tree, you can't cover up the fact that there's no fruit. Appearances do not count. Fruit does. John 15:5, Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If one remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. You see, we're redeemed to walk with God, to abide in Christ, and bear that spiritual fruit. And people can fake it. They can look good. It's like I tell you, you can fool me. You all clean up really well. You dress up really nice. But that's not the reality. The reality is, what's the fruit? The fruit of your life every day, not just the appearance. And those who are consumed with appearance will eventually get around to authority. And that's where we see the second thing, verses 23 through 27. They question the authority of Jesus. This was not illegitimate. They were responsible. The question, though it is legitimate, was absolutely unnecessary. Why? Because if they'd been paying attention, they would know who he was. But more importantly, they'd already made up their minds it didn't matter who he was. They had rejected him. This was another way of these religious leaders attempting to discredit Jesus before the people. They're questioning him about his credentials. Now, I understand all about that because I serve on the Committee on Ministry for the Presbytery. We had our West community meeting. All the churches in the western part of the Presbytery, we meet and do business for them, receive and dismiss pastors, deal with problems in the churches. I had to help conduct an exam Tuesday. It is important what you believe and where your credentials are and all those things. Yes, that's important. We're not saying that's not important. They're asking Jesus, by what authority do you teach and heal and cleanse right here in this temple? From what school did you get your degree? You ever seen people play that game? It's like holding cards. Well, where'd you get your degree? Oh, well, I went to the community college, and then I went to, oh, well, I went to so-and-so. Some of you've seen it. Yeah. Or, you know, if you're really good, you go, oh, I went to Carolina. And all the state fans go, I wouldn't be telling that. It becomes a game. It is nice to have a card in your pocket, though, sometimes, because when you have an accent like mine and people get talking to you and you see them looking down their nose like, well, you must have went to Sawdust University. You know, and finally somebody will push me and I'll say, well, yeah, when I was studying at Princeton. It's amazing. It's so much fun because it's like they really have lowered their standards, haven't they? You can see the look on their face. Well, they'll take anybody. You must have been the token Southerner they took, you know. You see all these things. Authority and credentials are important. But if you don't have the goods, it doesn't matter that you have the piece of paper. You see, many a person has earthly credentials, but not heavenly. And I don't care how many pieces of paper, how many seminary degrees you have, how many doctors after your name, if you do not minister in the power of the Holy Spirit of God, it doesn't matter. And I have known men and sat under them who had little education except they buried themselves in the Word of God. And the Holy Spirit taught them, and they taught with great effectiveness and pastored with great authority. Why? Because the authority that matters is the authority of God. The Pharisees would say, Jesus, you didn't graduate from our university. You didn't go to our seminary. Where did you get your credentials? Jesus answers their question with a question. And some people think, well, he was just evading the issue. No, he wasn't. He was using a very common rabbinical teaching technique. And that was to respond to a question with a question that the answer to that question would give the answer. So that the student was learning by thinking and processing. And the teacher was pointing them in the direction so they could come up with the answer. Very good way to teach. Jesus says to them, well, let me ask you, John's baptism, John the Baptist, his ministry, his baptism, was it from God or from men? Where did he get his authority? Now you stop and think about it. How they answer that question will answer their question about Jesus' authority. For if John the Baptist had the authority of God, then Jesus must have. And you say, well, where do you get that? It was John the Baptist who pointed to Jesus and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Listen to him. His followers left and began to follow Jesus. And he said, he must increase and I must decrease. John continually pointed to Jesus as the Messiah of God. So if John is speaking with the authority of God, then Jesus must be as well. But if John is not, then neither is Jesus. And Matthew, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, gives you their thought process. They're thinking, well, if we say that John is of God, then Jesus is going to say, then why didn't you believe him and follow him? Which by inference means, why aren't you following me? If we say, no, John's ministry was not of God, then the people are going to turn on us, for the people believe that John the Baptist was indeed a prophet of God. So what do? In my opinion, they take the coward's way out. They do that which is expedient for their purposes. We don't know. We don't know. And Jesus says, then I won't tell you either. Jesus sees through their game and he says, I won't play your game. But Matthew's narrative once again reaffirms to us, the reader, that Jesus is indeed the Christ of God with the authority to do these things. Remember, that's been Matthew's purpose the whole time. That's his purpose in writing, to point that Jesus of Nazareth is the Christ of God. He has the authority to do these things. Now let me ask you, if he is the Christ of God, then are you submitting your life to his authority? It's amazing to see how many people will say, oh, I'm trusting God, I know I'm going to heaven. Well, are you living for him, seeking to grow in him, walking with him? Well, I'm not real good at that part, but you go, oh, really? That's kind of like being married and never going home. You kind of married in name, but you have no relationship. And what makes you think that you'll have a wife or a husband when you do go home? You see, if he is the Christ of God, then you must submit to his authority, walk with him, grow in him. And Jesus strikes at the heart of the problem, and he does so by telling this parable. You're familiar with it, verses 28 to 32, the parable of the two sons. Jesus says, verse 31, which of the two did what his father asked? He's saying, which one did the will of his father? What was the will of the father? Go work in the field. The first one did what, I read this and I think, oh me, that sounds like me when I was a teenager. I'm not going to do that. Except usually I crouched it a little more politically correct so my dad didn't go off the deep end, because he didn't take no very well. I said, oh, Dad, I can't do that today. I've got this going on. And he'd say, well, I just know that yard better be mowed when I get home. You know, whatever you got to do, you deal with it, but that yard better be mowed. I was the one who said, well, I got this, that, and the other. No, I can't do it, but it always got done. My sister was like the other brother. Yeah, Daddy, I'll get my room cleaned up. She never did clean her room. My suggestion when I moved out was take a hand grenade, throw it in her room, and close the door and start over. When she moved out, Daddy said, I think we should have bought a hand grenade. Just two different kids, two different things. But Jesus says, here is something that teaches the truth of what's going on. There are many of you who are saying, oh, yes, I'm doing what God wants me to do. I love God. I'm serving him. Look at the tassels on my robe. Look at all the things. Look at my titles. Look at all this. And Jesus said, but they're not doing. They're not doing what the Father wanted them to do. That outward expression is not the reality. It's what's in the heart. And Jesus makes a most pointed statement. He says, the tax collectors, the most despised in Israel, and the prostitutes, the morally lowest in Israel, they are entering the kingdom before you, the high and mighty religious leaders. Because John came preaching repentance, and they listened. And even when you saw the power of God changing their lives, you refused to repent. You just pulled your robes a little tighter and stuck your nose up in the air a little higher. And he says, you won't enter the kingdom unless you repent. What about you? Do you put on a good show? Well, you can fool me, but it's not me you got to worry about. Do you have a relationship with God that's bearing fruit? Some of my fruit's a little stunted. It's not real pretty sometimes. But I look back over the long haul and see, God, you really have been there. You really have done stuff. Not where I was. And you know he's alive and at work in you. And others see that in you. Are you saying, yes, Lord, but not following Jesus? You know the best illustration of that I can think of is Judas Iscariot. Judas so fooled everybody that they made him the treasurer. And yet if you read John's gospel, you'll see at the end that John realized, and the rest of them did too, that Judas was not trustworthy, that he'd been dipping out of the till. He'd been stealing money from the rest of them. Oh, he looked good. He looked as good as any of them. And if we'd have picked out a disciple most likely to succeed, it would have been Judas. But he was the one who had never in his heart truly received Jesus. He had all the outward expressions, but not the inward reality. And what was the ultimate fruit? You know the end of that story. He betrayed Jesus, realized his mistake, but rather than repenting and begging for mercy, he goes out and hangs himself. And we see the fruit of his life. And I say, what about me? Lord, what about me? I'm pastor of a church. Surely I've got it together. You all know better than that. So I don't have it together, but I belong to him who does. So often we seem to think that we must hold on to God. But if you've raised little ones, you know that you can't trust them to hang on to you. They mean well, but they see something shiny and they let go and they run away, don't they? As a parent, you learn early that you have to hang on to them. How thankful I am that God hangs on to his children. And the way we know we are his is the fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. Do you see those things in your life? Do you see those manifested toward others? You say, well, I'm not there yet. None of us are. But hey, there's a little bud there. You know, I noticed yesterday I got blooms on one of my tomato plants. I'm waiting for that little bitty green tomato to show up. Not much, but it's fruit. Promises something better to come. Do you see that in your life? If so, rejoice. Keep walking with him, knowing that he has you. If not, isn't it time you did? Because you don't fool him. And in the judgment standing before him, all pretense will be gone. All appearances will be stripped bare. All the books in the world will be made right. And all the people who thought your grandfather was an institution in an institution will find out, no, he was just the murderer who was electrocuted. My prayer is that we would be people of authenticity and truth. So no one ever has to doubt who we belong to because of the fruit they see in us. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for reminding us that we're to walk with you and to be real. That can only happen as you continue your good work in us. May we ever repent and say yes to Jesus. Deliver us from mere appearance. But may our appearance ever honestly reflect Jesus. For we pray in his name, amen.